pastor feel very grateful, that we live in a country where we can make a three-digit phone call and have someone here in 4 or 5 minutes in an emergency. Concerned people around us, family members who are here in this church that care about Murray. Of course, their family was instrumental in starting this church. So even though it's distracting in a way, it's also grateful that it happens here, it happens in the community, it happens with the church family, it happens with family members around that can help, medical people who can help as well. So it alleviates at least some of the stress and something to be thankful for. Well, with that in mind, let me just very briefly go over just a couple of things that I wanted to say this morning. If you would, if you brought your Bible, look in John chapter 12. I want us to see one of the most beautiful, controversial, touching, and yet questionable scenes in the Gospels. Jesus is a guest at a dinner party. It's at Simon in the town of Bethlehem. He's the host. Mary and Martha, who were his usual host and hostesses, and Lazarus, their brother, were there. This was immediately after Jesus had been raised, Lazarus from the dead. He'd been in the grave, the tomb, for 4 days. It's only 6 days before Jesus is going to die on the cross. So when you understand the context, it's interesting. I mean, there's Martha, who was working in the kitchen, preparing the meal, and this was her offering. Mary represents work, service to God. And then there is Mary. Mary comes with a gift. She brings a bottle of perfume, and she worships Jesus at his feet. Then there is Lazarus. Lazarus, there's not one word that we read anything in the Bible Lazarus said. He's just a witness. But people had come to this party, to this dinner, in order to see a man who had been dead for 4 days and now was alive. You know, 5 minutes in heaven, these kinds of books, these kinds of stories, these kinds of movies, we all wonder about the afterlife. My goodness, what a witness, what a testimony Lazarus said. Yeah, I was dead for 4 days. I mean, I was beginning to smell. My body was deteriorating. You know, it reminds us as Christians that we die in Jesus Christ to sin and we're raised to walk in newness of life. Romans chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 2 says, because we were dead in our sin, we've been made alive through Jesus Christ and by grace through faith. The Bible tells us that if we've been raised with Christ, we're to seek the things that are above us. What a great witness Lazarus was. And then there's Judas. As we read the story in just a moment, Judas represents the wickedness because he judges Mary. He tries to find some fault. He won't accept the evidence that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So he turns around and accuses Mary, and then turns around and betrays Jesus. So here's this party. It's in full swing. Animated conversation, punctured by laughter. There's the clink of pottery. They're just having a great time listening to Lazarus tell about 4 days being dead and so on. And then here's what happens. I want to read it to you. Here's what happens. John chapter 12, 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. And a dinner party was given in Jesus' honor. Mary served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. And then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet, wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of her perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray and reject him, why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He didn't say it was because he cared about the poor. He said this because he was a thief, the keeper of the money bag. He used to help himself and what was put into it. Jesus said, leave her alone. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You'll always have the poor among you, but you'll not always have me. Well, here's the question. What would you do with a $20,000 bottle of perfume? I mean, how would you handle a $20,000 bottle of perfume? Probably I wouldn't want to. I'd be afraid to touch it. I'd be afraid I'd drop it. I mean, where would you keep a $20,000 bottle of perfume? In a safe? In a secret place in a compartment? Maybe in your closet. Maybe you'd want some homeowner's insurance to just be sure that you can have it insured in case of loss. But here's the big question I want to pose to you this morning. And the question is this. Is there any person, any man in your life so special you would take that $20,000 bottle of perfume and pour it out? Give it to them in one night. I think this is a very interesting scene here and something that we need to talk about, because you know what happens is here's this evening in full swing, and all of a sudden people are elbowing each other, sniffing in the air, and they're saying, it's nard. That's nard. Good gracious, what's come over that woman? Why would she do that? Because nard was, well, it originated in France. It was a French perfume, but it was made in India. And I mean, it was so prohibitively expensive. It was so rare. It was the ultimate luxury item. It was, I mean, here's the thing. There was nothing unusual about perfume or some kind of fragrance at a banquet. In fact, what was the perfume for? I mean, you filled festive spaces with some sort of heavenly fragrance. And why would you do that? 2,000 years ago, well, how can I say this delicately? But this was before people took baths every day. Okay, it was running water in a hot, no running water in a hot, sweaty climate. People had body odor. If you just want me to be honest about it, they had body odor. It stank. You say stank? I thought it was stunk. No, I looked it up. It's not a stunk. That's a past participle. Stunk is a past. It stank. People stink. I mean, they smell bad. Let me put it that way. Right? They smell bad. So on a social occasion, you get a lot of people together rubbing elbows. You would do something like Chanel number 5 or whatever it is. You would Chanel 8, whatever number, I forget. You put it out there and fill the room with a little bit of aroma. And that's what Mary's doing here. But she's doing more than that. I mean, on a super special occasion, you might put a dab or two. But Mary brought the perfume, and she just gave it all. And it brought the house down. In fact, Mark says in Mark chapter 14 and verse 5 that they rebuked her, the guests, they rebuked her harshly. They rebuked her harshly. And I looked at it in the original language, in the Greek language, and it means to bellow with anger, to roar like an animal. Good heavens, what did this woman do to cause such a disturbance? So much distraction. Here was a room full of people, and they start yelling at this poor woman. She did four things that I want to share with you. Number one, she went overboard. And that's what love does. Love always goes overboard. She broke the jar. Mark chapter 15, verse 14. She broke the jar. She didn't just pour out the perfume. I mean, she broke the jar and whoosh! And that oil went everywhere. It was in a puddle on the floor all at once. And unless Mary and Martha and Lazarus were extremely wealthy, this probably was the most expensive thing that they owned. And it was gone just like that. Verse 3, did you see that? It says, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. Mark says it was an alabaster jar of perfume. It was a precious heirloom that had been passed down from one member of the family to the next. Essentially, basically what I'm trying to say is Mary blew her family's financial security right there on that spot. Their nest egg just dribbled on the floor. I mean, and when they first saw Mary bringing that perfume into the room, they thought, well, isn't that sweet? That's nice. Now they're appalled. They hit the ceiling. They think, what in the world were you thinking, woman? Why would you do that? Why? I mean, that's an entire year's salary down the drain. You know what I think? I think Mary just smiled. I just think that she was very content with what she had done. Judas obviously had never been in love. He had never loved like Mary loved. And if you've been in love, you know what love does to you. I mean, love just makes you do things that you wouldn't do otherwise. Pascal said, when one does not love too much, one does not love enough. I mean, you just love. To be in love is to be swept out of bounds, to do things beyond reason. I mean, you cry, you dance, you sing. I mean, you just do things. You change your hairstyle every 2 weeks. You change your wardrobe. I mean, you're concerned. I mean, you tell a teenager, you say, hey, listen, it's the prom. You don't have to, break the bank. You spend your whole life savings on this, taking this girl to this dance. You don't have to take her to Tony's. I mean, just take her up the street here to Los Cucos. I mean, use your head. Be reasonable. You don't want to waste your money like that. But you see, Pascal also said, the heart has reasons that reason knows nothing of. See, when you're in love, you just do things that you wouldn't think that, is reasonable. Money, I think, really wasn't the problem with Judas. Judas was taking it anyway. I think it was PDA. You know what I mean by PDA? It was a public display of affection. Can you imagine what would happen out here in Carlton Woods at some holiday dinner party? And there would be a sudden, shocking, public display of affection. How people would just gasp in horror. Just instinctively pull back and say, what a waste. I mean, you shouldn't be doing like that. I mean, doesn't someone's over display of affection kind of creep you out? In fact, I've been on a crusade for several years as a pastor. I don't know how to say this, but having done hundreds of weddings, it's amazing what can take place at the end of a wedding when I say, now you may kiss your bride. Now, through the years, when I have premarital counseling with couples, I've always encouraged them to have a nice Christian kiss done decently in order. You know what I mean? But through the years, I mean, it seems to become more and more expansive. I mean, I could write a book about things that have taken place just inches from my eyes. I mean, I wonder, I'm standing here and I say, how can they hold their breath that long? I've seen mothers cover their eyes and their children. They don't want to see it. So what I've been trying to do here recently is just kind of, counsel, coach the couple before the wedding. I say to them, I say, this shouldn't be, when I say you may kiss your bride, this shouldn't be like it's your first kiss ever. I don't expect that. But don't act like it's going to be your last kiss ever. I mean, seriously, but it's a losing cause. Something about love just makes you go overboard. That's what Mary was doing. I remember the church I was with in Midland. There was a guy there, a wealthy old man, and his daughter, I think she was probably in her late 30s, was getting married, became engaged. He was thrilled. He didn't think the only girl, he didn't think she'd ever get married. And I mean, for the wedding ceremony, he flew in a 300-pound wedding cake from California. I mean, we had to have a forklift to take that cake into the reception hall. His wife said, Betty Ann, she said, Luther, she said, we only having 600 guests come. I mean, that's going to be a half a pound of cake for every guest here. And he just shrugs his shoulders and says, so? I mean, he cared about it. We had cake, by the way, in the freezer, I mean, for months. I mean, we had to throw it away. But I mean, a father's love knows no bounds. He just goes on. Think about it. Didn't our Heavenly Father go overboard in his love and his affection? I mean, I don't think any of us would have complained if God had just made one kind of flower, the way Henry Ford made cars. But I mean, God didn't. I mean, what if we just had one basic flower, just a yellow daffodil, stripped down, just plain? I mean, we'd say, we didn't know any better. Flowers are great. They're beautiful. We love flowers. But see, God's love so goes beyond the boundaries of just normality that there's not only daffodils, but there are irises and poppies and azaleas and daisies and roses. And I mean, you know, you've got places like Callaway Gardens in Georgia, if you've ever been there, or Bucharest Garden in Victoria, Canada. I mean, it's amazing. It's just beauty. Because God says, it's all good. Here in Houston, we live in a beautiful place here in Houston. In the springtime, early March, I mean, you go down to the Heights, you go down to River Oaks, I mean, it just gardens there. I remember several years ago after Ike, I took 2 different weeks. We took people down to Galveston to work on homes. Some of you were in there. You worked with them. And we were, I remember the second week we went down, and we were in some kind of house, and we were ripping up the floor, and water had been in there. And I said, man, what a lousy house. I wonder what their view would be. I mean, even if this house was reconstructed, and they were going to try to reconstruct it. And I'm looking out the front picture window of that house, and you can look through a couple of palm trees, and you could see in the distance the blue Gulf of Mexico. And I'm thinking, you know, when the sun comes up and the sun goes down over there, I mean, people would pay hundreds of dollars for that view. I mean, that's what God does. God just gives us more than we can possibly make. And so here is Judas. Judas is complaining about what Mary has done. That money should have gone to a food bank. That money should have helped the homeless. I mean, he was showboating his social conscience. Every once in a while, especially around Christmas, we have a lot of it here. You hear the same thing. You hear people say, oh, well, why waste that money on buildings? Why waste that money on religion? Instead, we ought to focus on people's education or people's health or people's housing or people's food or self-esteem seminars or whatever it is, psychobabble of some kind. The point is that we remember that God is a God who's given generously. And he's gone overboard. And love responds in the same way. It just goes overboard. You know, Kobe Bryant was here. I was reading in the paper last night with the Lakers. He's making his farewell tour. And I think about Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan, when he won the first of his 6 NBA titles, it was 3 years after his father had been murdered on the side of a road in North Carolina. After they won there, he came into the dressing room and he just laid down on the floor and he just began to sob. And the reporters, of course, they wanted to congratulate him. They wanted to interview him. And they were all afraid to approach Michael Jordan. I mean, what would you say? I mean, no one knew what to say. Do you just leave him alone? But everyone knew what was happening. It was Father's Day. It was on a Sunday, Father's Day, he wins his first NBA title, and his dad is not there. Put his hand on his shoulder and say, son, I'm proud. You've done good. And reporter after reporter wanted to ask him how he felt after he went. But, you know, for Michael Jordan, none of it mattered. Because the one person that was significant in his life wasn't there to share what his greatest goal had been. And to me, that's a parable of what life's about. Because after all, we get all this stuff, and we're successful to some degree, and a lot of our dreams come true, but somehow there's a void, there's an emptiness in our heart, in our life, longing because the Father wants to celebrate with us, but we don't have any kind of relationship with Him. For Mary, having Jesus Christ in that room and everything, she took that alabaster jar, that expensive jar of perfume, and she just threw it on the floor to Christ. And that oil went everywhere. And then I want you to see what else she did. She pours it all over Jesus' feet. Because you see, love doesn't hold back. Love does not hold back. In fact, one of the most demeaning and humiliating things you could do in that culture was to touch somebody's feet. Now, we had slavery in our country, but the slavery in the United States was much worse than slavery in the first century. Jewish slaves had rights. And they certainly didn't have to touch feet. Rabbis taught slaves, listen, you never have to be asked to unlatch people's shoes. You don't have to be required to touch their feet. You can bring a basin of water and a towel, and you can wash their feet like Mary. But Mary did something more. She massaged Jesus' feet. What does Mary say? Mary saying, Lord, I'm going to do anything for you that I can possibly can. A slave won't touch your feet, but I'm going to touch your feet. I'm going to kneel down. I'm going to touch your feet. I'm going to just put this oil and massage it all over your feet. I want you to know, Lord, everything that I am is yours. All that I am, all that I have, I give it to you. Not 10%, not 50%, but not 90%. Every cell in my body. God, I love you. I belong to you from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. Everything is yours, Lord. Everything. You ever heard that song by John Legend, All of Me? I have Sirius in my car, and every once in a while, Sid will be in there with me, and John Legend, come on. And that's, you know, I just enjoy having her. You know, what is it that I looked at words. All of me loves all of you. Loves your curves and all your edges, all your perfect imperfections. Give your all to me, I'll give my all to you. You're my end, my beginning. Even when I lose, I'm winning. Because I give you all of me, and you give me all of you. See, that's Mary's attitude toward Jesus Christ. Maybe you're generous. Maybe you're a generous person. But this morning, I'm challenging you. I'm challenging myself. Jesus deserves all we have, even our imperfections. We need to give him our all. And I'll tell you what else Mary did. Mary not only went beyond boundaries, I mean, she went overboard. Not only did she not hold back, but she gave all. She gave it all. God says, give your all to me. You know why? Because I gave my all to you. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. And friends, that's the mystery. That's the key to unlocking the mystery of this story this morning of what Mary did. And why she did. Mary saw what no one else in that room saw. It was really almost a pantomime of her love song to Jesus. She knew that Jesus was going to go to the cross and die. Everybody else hadn't grasped that yet. I'm giving my all to you, she seemed to say, because you're going to give your all to me. Mary saw the cross coming. Mary saw the timing. I mean, if you understand the timing, the very next day is Palm Sunday when Jesus enters into Jerusalem and everybody says, Hosanna, oh, Hosanna. Glory to him who comes in the highest. If you were spending your last evening with someone that you really love, someone that you really care about, I mean, what would you hold back? What would you say? Well, you know, if you knew this was the last time, you wouldn't hold anything back. Mary knew the timing. Knowing about Jesus was to pour her life, his life for her. Mary ran and got the most priceless thing that she possibly could, and she brought it to Jesus, and she gave it. I mean, what's your worship like this morning? It's so easy to become distraction. Is there a missing tingle in your life? I mean, it just some kind of formality, some kind of ritual, just kind of a churchianity that runs through it, just going through the motions, wrapped in the trappings of some kind of religion? Or is it real, genuine, and personal? I mean, Mary poured out all her perfume. Love goes overboard. Mary touched the feet of Jesus. Love doesn't hold back, it doesn't shrink. Mary saw the cross coming. She gives all. And I'll tell you one other thing before I finish that Mary did. Mary let down her hair, shook the tresses of her hair. Then she knelt down. Instead of using a towel, She used her hair to wipe the feet of Jesus. I mean, that's incredible. You see the scandal? It's love without boundaries. It's love without boundaries. That's what she got yelled at. Rabbis warned women, cautioned women, never let your hair down in public. In fact, for a married woman, that was grounds for divorce. It still is in the Middle East. That's why they wear those hats. Mary let her hair down. She rubbed the perfume with her hair. It was an act of love. It was an act of total intimacy, of caring. See, it's possible to do number one and two. Love goes overboard. Love doesn't hold back. To be extravagant, to surrender anything, you know. Even though, but what Mary's saying is, not only am I going to give you everything that I have, not only am I going to surrender myself to you, I'm going to love every moment of it. I'm going to be so close to you, I'm going to let my hair down. We still use that expression today. Who do we let our hair down with? Well, the people we love. The people who know us the best. The people that we trust. That's who we let our hair down with. Mary's letting her hair down. You know, and I'm saying to you this morning, Jesus wants to be one of those people that you can let your hair down. Jesus wants to be one of those people that you can trust, that you can share the intimate corners of your world. Let him in on your worries. Let him in on your frustrations and your concerns. I challenge you, tomorrow morning, spend some time with him over a cup of coffee and just reflect on your life. Let Jesus know about it. Talk to Jesus about it. I mean, I call it a quiet time. It's just a prayer time. It's just a time alone with God. You know, a woman who really wasn't a believer, really, she refused to believe in God. She was watching the Milagro Beanfield War. And a migrant was in the field, and he was wore a t-shirt that said, "God loves me." And she wondered, she kind of, you know, stepped back. She said, why would anybody want to demean their God by putting it on a t-shirt? And then she began to reflect on it more and more, and she thought, God is close to that man. God is part of that man's life. Even when he's working in a field, he thinks that Jesus is with him. And it struck her that Jesus Christ is with believers, even in the nitty-gritty times. And then she closes, this was Anne Rice, by the way, she closes by saying, God is with us even like mud flaps on a truck. Well, you know, go ahead. Let God be close. Let him be yourself. Invite him in. Let down your hair. Even put Jesus on a t-shirt. I mean, he is with you. He's with you all the way. What we're going to do this morning now as we